Hi, everyone.
Hi.
I'd like to welcome everyone to the work meeting of ZLR tonight. Again, it is a work meeting, and that means that the public hearings have been held for all the petitions we're going to discuss tonight. First of all, I'm going to introduce everyone. On the far end of the table over there is the, I always trip up on the title, Planning and Development Director Todd Violante. And working our way down the table is Julia Hammond. She's our student member. And we've just been joined by Heidi Wiglander, Supervisor Heidi Wiglander. Next to her is Supervisor Kristen Audette. Next to her is Supervisor Jason Canole. And I'm Jerry Bolling. And over on this side of the table, we have
Majid Allen.
Majid Allen, who's the assistant planner.
Right? I'm a planner, senior planner.
Senior planner.
But I think you were going to say assistant zoning administrator. That's his title.
That's his title.
It's all right. We're fairly interchangeable parts here.
Well, you have to be, don't you? And then, Dan, what is your assistant zoning administrator?
So he's the,
Dan Everson. He just introduced you. So. Now that we all know who we are.
There'll be a quiz at the end.
Yeah. I'll probably feel it.
A quiz for Jerry.
Yeah. Yep. A quiz for me. So, next item on the agenda is public comment for any matter not listed on the agenda. Anyone wishing to speak on an item not listed on the agenda has 5 minutes to speak. The issue may be placed on a future agenda if the committee so decides. Does anyone have an item they'd like to discuss that is not listed on the agenda? Okay. I believe we can go right into the petitions now.
We have a couple of sets of minutes, from previous meetings.
Yeah, we've got consideration of minutes. We've got minutes from August 13th and August 27th. Would someone like to bring forward a motion on those minutes?
Move to approve.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion, corrections? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The minutes are approved. Next, we have the zoning map amendments and conditional use permits from previous meetings. First up is rezone 11406, Stephen Cullen.
That's us. Come on.
Well, I guess if we want you to speak, we'll call on you.
This is Steve and I'm Jan.
Okay.
And he can't hear very well, so if you have any questions, I'll...
Why don't you have a seat since he can't hear very well?
So sure, this item had been postponed from...
the last
meeting on the 27th to provide time for staff to work with the town and the Collins to figure out an arrangement that would work, make sure that everyone was on the same page. The town has approved the petition with a requirement that a building envelope be identified on their proposed lot one, because there are some wetlands and I believe floodplain present portions of the property. And then the proposed lot two would be zoned FP1, which is our farmland preservation category, does not allow any residential or non-farm development, and the recommendation for that, again, given the presence of environmental features, is that there be a restriction prohibiting any structural development on it, simply because it would not not practical in the first place, but this way there's advance notice to anyone purchasing that property in the future as to that prohibition.
Okay.
So, yeah, we have staff recommended conditions just to shore it up that the almost 5-acre lot be zoned RR4 with a building envelope, and the proposed lot two go to FP1 with a restriction prohibiting residential or other structural development.
Okay. Any comments from the committee? Any questions from the petitioner? Are you okay with everything you've heard?
Yes. When you started, you said something about lot one. But lot one, correct, is where we can put one piece of, one building.
Right, up in this area right here.
Yeah, that's correct. Otherwise, the rest we agree with.
So the lot one is just saying, you've got more in lot one than just that little area, but that's the only area you can put the building because of the wetlands.
Wetlands, I get it. Correct.
Would someone like to make, bring forward a motion?
Move to approve.
With conditions.
Very good. Is there a second?
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any further discussion or comments? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Folks are all set for this evening. Thanks
for
coming.
Thank you very much.
And next we have rezone number 11427, Mr. Murky.
Okay, come up.
It's up to you. Yeah, you're a frequent flyer, so you might as well. Report.
So this petition had been previously approved by the committee, went all the way to county board, but then wanted to another change to the.
It wasn't my fault. It's the lot owner.
I get it. another change to this would expand the size of one of the lots in the plat. And so it came back to ZLR to, you know, to get clearance for adding about 5 acres to the proposed lot two. And so I believe, if I'm not mistaken, is this the one we want, Jeff?
Yes.
So again, no net addition of residential development. The lot sizes are expanding. The only difference between this layout and what the ZLR previously approved is the addition of another 5 acres of wooded and slash wetland area to go with lot two. Otherwise, everything else remains the same. Let's see here if we've got the recommended condition. So we had 4 recommended conditions, and staff would recommend that those be again required as conditions of approval. And that is that there be a development restriction or environmental setback line, essentially to denote the location of wetlands on the lots that the building sites, and that's actually in on lots 3 and 4, excuse me. And we're going to RR8 with the zoning for these lots, and we're going to add in, I guess we would amend the zoning district boundaries to show in the concept plan map dated. What do we have from Dave? Couldn't quite make that out on the digital copy here.
7/8/19.
Okay, so it is the same. Got it. So July 8th of 2019, and let a plat be recorded with the register of deeds. So again, the only thing changing with this one from the previous approval was the addition of the 5 acres to the existing lot two.
Is that your report?
That's it.
Motion, please, or questions?
I have a question. The staff update says that there's an additional improvement of the environmental setback line being placed because of the wetland complex. Is that an addition?
So this would be in addition. So right now, I believe it's on lots 3 and 4. But this would be also including it on lot two. And I apologize. Roger did the update on this one. And in fact, I thought we had it on more than that. But that's it. Just so 2, 3, and 4, we would want to show that that line, essentially to put everyone on notice that you can't build, obviously, in wetlands or within the wetland buffer area. Thank you for pointing.
Anyone have any question or motion?
Move to approve with conditions.
And a second, please. Got a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We got her done, John.
Thank you all.
Yeah.
Although it jinxed it, Jerry.
Yeah, we still have to get the plat approved.
I'm not jinxing it. It's done. It's done. Next we have rezone number 11447, the property owners of the town of Burke, McGee.
So there were 4 parcels in the town of Burke where we got the zoning district classification and the switch to the new ordinance. wrong. And this, by and large, has to do with, well, in one case, you know, just the wrong, based on the lot size. So we have RR8 going to RR4. We do have one case where we had zoned something residential that should be commercial because it's part of the commercial operation. And then a cemetery that's going from residential to recreational. There's a joke in there somewhere, but I'm not going to make it. Anyway, the only thing we've been waiting on here was town action on it, and they approved it with no conditions.
Good. Any questions or motion?
Move to approve.
And a second.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any further discussion on this? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Next up, we have petition CUP 2476, Slater Diedrich. Hey, Slater.
How are you guys today?
Good, how are you?
Good.
Majid, your report, please.
Yeah, so this one was postponed. The proposal is for essentially conditional use permit would bring the existing residents into compliance with zoning. Limited commercials is going to allow, well, the conditional use would also allow outdoor storage. And this is essentially to bring an existing use into compliance. That's a tree service business that Slater runs. So we're recommending five conditions. Some of which are standard in the ordinance now, and I don't know if you had looked these over or not, but so obviously conditional use allowing for your house, outdoor storage, just stating what the permit is for. You know, if you're going to be putting up any new buildings, you got to meet applicable code requirements. Again, most of these are just stating the obvious. And obviously, we don't want you storing anything in the floodplain or wetlands, and comply with state standards for storage of gas or diesel fuel.
Any questions from the committee?
Move approval of conditions.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Slater, you're all set.
Thank you.
What's the name of your business?
Slater Diedrich Tree Care.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, let's move on to plats and CSMs. First, we have the Bittersweet preliminary plat.
Yeah, both the plats that are located in the townships are before you for a acceptance and scheduled for future consideration, which will most likely be September 24th. So first one is the plat or the rezone we just talked about a little bit earlier, Town of Deerfield. It's a Bittersweet, five lots, 59.6 acres is what it's been revised to. Rezone, obviously, was just approved shortly, a little bit ago. So there really isn't much as far as you know, comments or conditions at this point. Reached out, haven't heard anything from the DOT. Our county surveyor doesn't have any comments at this time. And so there's a shared driveway easement that's already been recorded from a previous rezone a year or so ago. So that's already been taken care of. So most likely you'll see this September 24th for conditional approval.
Very good. Any questions? Or?
Are you serious? Can I ask a question, or does it have to be one of you guys?
Go ahead, and I'll let you ask your question.
Okay, this is our plat, and
oh, okay.
So
come on up.
So, I'm just wondering, really, what the next step is. Now, I come back here on September 24th.
You don't need to.
No.
No. No, I'm pretty much working specifically, you know, through Dave. He's the one that's kind of supplying me all the information that
okay.
I need.
Okay, and then you have you been in contact with Scott Hinkle or not?
No.
Okay, I was, but that's fine. And then the county board meeting then is the 19th, is that correct?
So county board meeting would be for your zoning approval.
Right.
And generally the rule of thumb is if you come out of the zoning committee with a unanimous recommendation to approve,
okay.
You don't need to attend, you certainly okay. are welcome to, but usually they act on all zoning petitions.
The way
in a
So my question is then, what is my next step? I mean, you guys all have your thing in.
Once the conditional approval is squared away for the preliminary plat, mm-hmm. then I'll send out a letter to Dave stating, hey, the plat was conditionally approved on September 24th. I'll copy the township as well, all the other interested parties. I don't think there's anything as far as any extraterritorial jurisdiction with all that. So you're good there. And then Dave can go ahead and prepare and ultimately submit the final plat. Same process, it's got to go through the committee twice, one for conditional approval, and then once the last meeting would be for the signature, the final signature of the plat, which is signed by the chair of this committee, and then it can be recorded.
Okay, so lot three, who wants to get started on their house, we're a couple months out yet, or?
Yeah, so if you got conditional approval by September 24th, I would think somewhere by the end of October, you're looking pretty good. Just to be on the safe side. So, yeah.
All right. Thank you all very much.
Yeah. You're welcome, Jeff. Any questions from the committee? Any motions?
I don't think I had a motion yet.
Oh.
For the acceptance.
No, we haven't. That's.
I didn't write anything down yet.
No, I just asked for it.
Move to approve.
Well, it's just, we're just accepting the plat.
Oh,
just
or move to
for
accept.
Review.
Move to accept.
And then we schedule for, future consideration.
Yeah, there you go. Is there a second?
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Pioneer Point.
Pioneer Point, preliminary plat, Town of Middleton, section 29 and 30. This one consists of 97 lots. A little over 127 acres. The rezone petition 11379 was approved September 5th by County Board. And this is, you know, in a nutshell, kind of a draft working document with regards to, you know, the proposed conditions that you'll see in 2 weeks. So there's quite a bit more with this one. There was quite a few conditions that came out of the rezone process. Still need to get, you know, squared away with regards to the public land appropriation, you know, what's being dedicated as park land, are they going to be paying the fees in lieu of, so there's some things like that that need to be worked out yet, so. But yeah, other than that, should be fairly straightforward.
All right, would someone like to make a motion to accept the plat and schedule for future consideration?
So moved.
Second, please.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. John of Village.
Yeah, so this one's in the city of Madison. Go back. Yeah, so this one consists of 59 lots, three outlots, 43 acres, just north of Commercial Avenue there, on the west-hand side of Felland. So there's direct access to a major corridor. Outlot 3 is being shown dedicated to the public for park purposes. So, and then outlots 1, 3, and 4 are being dedicated for stormwater purposes. So this is before you for a certification of non-objection. So.
Any questions? Motion, please.
Move to approve certification of non-objection.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Move on to resolutions, and we have resolution 205, review of county department equity plans. So I assume we have we're going to talk about the zoning equity plan. Is that your baby, Todd?
Yeah, I think we can talk about it now, or I don't know what the objective is of the resolution, if it's intended to take it up now or a later date, but I can certainly talk to it now, and we can talk more about it at another occasion during the budget process. So clearly, this is something that we support and endorse. We have been very active on the front of promoting racial equity and social justice through our activities in the department. We are one of the 13 that has not submitted their plan to OEI, but it's a work in progress, and we are working on it. But I could give you some an example of some of the things we have been involved in. So we have been I personally have been an active participant in all of the racial equity and social justice meetings, if not all of them, virtually all of them. There's the department manager team that has representation from most of the departments in the county, and it's regularly coordinated by the Office of Equity and Inclusion, and have been an active participant in that. We had a department kickoff meeting that we coordinated, where Wes Sparkman, Carrie Braxton, Steve Steinhoff, and myself presented to our department in this very room on the importance of racial equity and social justice. And then there was a component of that that's of interest to our department that talked about the relationship between land use and equity. And one of the highlights of that was the practice of redlining. And if you're not familiar with that, essentially in the late 1930s, there was a practice where certain neighborhoods by the Home Ownership Loan Corporation was 1937 when it was active, promoted a practice for lending purposes of identifying certain neighborhoods that were of high risk for mortgage investment and low risk. And the low risk neighborhoods were essentially those areas that were very homogenous, predominantly white, very affluent, and a very homogenous ethnic makeup. And they color-coded the maps. The low-risk areas were identified as green, and the intermediate areas in terms of risk were yellow and blue, and then the high-risk areas were red, and thus the term redlining. So there was this relationship between even our federal government had supported this practice of redlining to as a guidance to the mortgage and lending industry. So you have this legacy, and we have it here in Madison. We found documents that we can access the Hulk maps that were done for many metropolitan areas throughout the United States, and we can provide you with the website. At a university on the East Coast, I don't know if it was South Carolina or Virginia, you can view some of these maps, and it's really interesting to view them. So at any rate, some of our work, I helped put together a presentation on redlining and this relationship between land use and race and equity for the Land and Water Resources Department when they had their kickoff. I presented it to our department when we had our kickoff, and also presented it to the Racial Equity and Social Justice County team. So we've got this presentation, and we can even share components of it with you at a future meeting if you'd like. But we have examples, and we found examples in our department from documents. Just randomly, we found in Maple Bluff, City of Monona, and in the Crestwood neighborhood, examples of covenants and restrictions that were based on race. With varying language, some of it was standard language, seemed to be model language, perhaps perpetuated by lawyers and real estate realtors at the time, that limited or prohibited persons of color from living in certain areas. There was one area, I don't know if anybody is familiar with Carson Gully,
mm-hmm.
that name ring a bell.
Yep.
He was, for those that don't, was a prominent member, actually a chef for the university in Carson Gully on campus. I mean, the campus is named after him. But he was also a well-known chef and personality in the Madison area. He and his wife tried to live in the Crestwood neighborhood on the east side, the Near East Side, and there was a restriction in that neighborhood, and they had to get an action of the homeowners association to allow he and his wife to either buy or build a home there. And it was a split vote, but it was this covenant on the neighborhood that prohibited he and his wife initially from being able to live there. And we have an example of that actually in our office. So some of our activity on this front is learning about this, educating others about it. Our hope ultimately is to have a component of our website that will have information on our equity plan, but also talking about this relationship of race and equity and land use, which is an important one to us. We also formed a working group in our department after, shortly after our kickoff. We had a 7-member work group that had 2 members from each of our divisions, as well as myself. And we reviewed equity plans of other departments. We viewed a PBS video on the Race, the Power of Illusion. If you haven't seen it, it's an excellent PBS documentary. We viewed all 3 episodes of that as a work group. And we were moving down that path of preparing our plan, but we started to get bogged down in envisioning this much larger plan document. So I think what we're going to try and do is scale that back a little bit initially, cut to the chase, and get some of our primary object goals and objectives down and get that submitted to OEI, but then continue to work on our plan and this larger vision that we've got for it. Some of the other activities that we've been involved in, our staff has participated in multiple trainings. We had the only county staff person in our department that we sent to the GEAR training, the Government Alliance on Race and Equity in New Mexico. Diana Gonzalez went and then came back and reported back to us with 2 city staff that went to the training. We participated in the Dane County Boys and Girls Club internship 2 summers in a row now. We have an outstanding intern that has been with us for the past year, who was a student at Madison College and is now a student at UW in civil and environmental engineering, who does a lot of mapping work for us, and we would love to hire her part-time, but we have her at least as an intern now on a part-time basis. Also the Simpson Street Free Press, we've provided a host of information on a number of projects we're involved in. And the Simpson Street Free Press is a Southside newspaper that engages youth in studying different issues and then reporting on them, and they learn to write, they learn to report and analyze. So we provided information and offered our availability for interviews and helping to promote the land use professions with children of color. And hopefully we can promote the interest in it and hopefully then into the Boys and Girls Club internship program, we can begin to hopefully continue to build that interest and perhaps grow future zoning professionals and land use professionals, planners, mapping specialists. So right now, our department is predominantly middle-aged white men, and we are moving toward more women in the department. The last more than half dozen of our hires have been women, and the last 2 of recent have been women of color. One of our interns is part-time, and she's an intern, and then we have an LTE clerical staff person as well that we've just brought on board. And so we're hopefully moving in the right direction in terms of gender equity and increasing the diversity of our department. We staff the Dane County Complete Count Committee that's just taking off this week. They'll have their first meeting. This is the committee of the that was pulled together by resolution, if you recall it, that is looking to promote awareness of the census coming up in April of 2020, and with the objective of trying to reach hard-to-count communities and underrepresented communities. So we are going to be very active in that effort in staffing this committee. We also staff the Dane County Housing Initiative through Olivia Perry of our office. She is preparing for the Dane County Housing Summit coming up October 10th. And in addition to affordable housing and promoting affordable housing, there's a strong nexus there between diversity and equity and inequity in our housing markets and the availability of affordable housing. And that's the whole focus of the Dane County Housing Initiative. And the Housing Summit, this is the 5th year of the summit. And the summit this year will include a breakout session relating to the relationship between affordable housing, equity, as well as health. The next item, actually, we've taken part in a couple of different efforts. One you have on your agenda tonight relating to Squaw Bay, changing that to Muskrat Bay on Lake Monona. But we've also been active. Our department, Hans Hilbert of our office, is going to be making that application assuming you may approve the resolution tonight, that initiates an effort to change that, the name of that bay officially. So we have offered to do that, to take the lead in that application, and Hans was also successful in changing the name of a creek in the town of Westport to Ella Wheeler Wilcox Creek. It's a creek near her, if you're, she's a famous author, poet, from Dane County, and there was an effort to change the name of a creek to acknowledge her and to honor her, and our office was at the forefront of that. So the we have a, one of our, my favorite ideas came from Diana Gonzalez. We, in our office that I mentioned earlier, we publish every 2 years the Dane County Plat Book. I don't know if you've seen that, but it's this incredible publication that our mapping staff, Aaron Krebs of our office and Kurt Kroll of our office collaborate on. We used to buy these plat maps or plat books of all of the Dane County communities from Rockford Maps. And a number of years ago, our staff thought, we can do this. Why are we buying these? So we began preparing this publication. It's a wonderful book. It includes detailed maps and all the ownership of the parcels in those jurisdictions, as well as a companion map of an aerial photograph and the topography of the leaf maps of that jurisdiction. And every 2 years, we publish this and we sell them. Well, Diana had this great idea to, what if in that publication we highlighted and recognized and honored some cultural group, you know, within Dade County. So that the next publication for 2020, we're thinking of incorporating our Native American heritage and having, working with the Ho-Chunk Nation and others to provide educational information that we can include on the inside cover and on the cover of it, have some feature of the landscape that honors that cultural heritage, as well as recognizing certain sites that are important to that culture on a map inside the plat book. And then every 2 years being able to do that with any, you know, cultural, historical member of our community within Dade County. So we think that's a wonderful idea. We're very excited about it. That is some of the activity we've been involved in on this front, although we haven't completed our plan. We will, and we're very happy to do that and be part of it, and we'll continue this work in the future. So.
Okay, thanks, Todd.
Excuse me, I'm losing my voice.
That's okay. anyone have any questions for Todd about the
Resolution 235
equity plan or the Scalping name change?
For the resolution, I think before us to approve it, and then therefore, if so, that we review the department equity plans. Do you have an idea of when that might be available for this committee to review?
I think in October. My goal is to have a draft available by the end of this month. Getting at the salient elements that what we've decided is that we don't want to get bogged down in this grand vision and then stagnate and struggle with it and not move it forward. So we want to hit some of the salient elements. We know what many of our goals are going to be and some of the objectives and how we want to get there. We're already moving forward on many aspects of it. So we want to try and get that submitted to OEI and within the department, get some feedback and get that to OEI so we have that presence on the website. We can begin to create a page on our website that includes that plan, some of this information on redlining and cultural heritage and our plat map and so forth. But then continue over the course of the next year to build on over time and into the future. But I'm hoping in October that we'll have something. So once that's done, perhaps when we're reviewing our department budget, maybe we can present on the next step of it.
Yeah, that's what it's.
Hopefully we can hit that one.
Anyone else have questions on either right resolution? It doesn't have a name yet.
235.
235. Yes.
mean, speaking of redlining and speaking of the inequities and injustices in housing that have existed for a long time because of laws and practices, does part of your maybe grander vision or even something more short-term envision the department taking a more active role in advancing housing justice in Dane County? Because, I mean, you know, you're already involved with Olivia staffing this, you being involved in the Affordable Housing Fund review team.
Right.
But we don't have a lot of staff capacity.
Yeah.
Right? So I'm wondering, and I know there's not necessarily money we're giving you to get more, you know, but is that something that's been discussed at all or something you see part of your work? I don't know if I'm saying this very well, but I'm,
yeah.
You know, the county's vast and broad and it's bureaucracy and a lot of different areas touch on housing, but one area that has a kind of, I don't know, higher view or vision and is planning, and so I'm wondering if you're thinking about that at all in the equity.
Yeah, I mean, we're certainly open to ideas. So we're going to continue with the Dane County Housing Initiative, continue our involvement in all of the racial equity objectives of the county and the RESJ team. My hope would be, ultimately, I would love to have a really good informational piece on this relationship between land use and equity and have a presence on our website. It's like an informational piece on it. There's a great link to that university site, and I actually talked to one of the professors that was involved in putting that together, and they were having some issues with one of the links, and I was trying to use it and just called them. So, you know, I hope that's a resource that we can incorporate as part of an educational effort. In terms of the relationship between geography, land use, equity, housing, CARPC did a really, really good analysis. It was part of a grant they received a number of years ago, but it was both an EPA and a HUD grant. And as part of that, they had to do something called a fair housing equity assessment that delves into sort of the racial distribution of population by race in Dane County, as well as average household income. And that highlighted a number of the disparities that we have throughout the county and the segregation we have in many areas by race and income. And it becomes apparent when you're looking at these patterns on the map. So I think incorporating some of that information on our website and somehow incorporating that into our housing discussion going forward. It's clearly, like with the Affordable Housing Development Fund, I just finished reviewing all 15 and got my scores done and have to get them to Dave in the morning. But one of the things that we want to see and that we're scoring more highly is that distribution of housing and affordable housing and supportive housing throughout the county instead of seeing it clustered in, you know, pieces of parts of downtown Madison and south of the Beltline, and to see it in Mount Horeb and Cottage Grove and places like that.
Where there's no transit.
Well, I mean, that's something we have to balance, right? Right. Most of them were in the city of Madison, with very, very good transit access. But yeah, we definitely want to continue to be part of that, and we're certainly open and receptive to ideas that the board has about how we can continue.
But I mean, because we have a robust report from Dr. Paulson, but.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have a plan. You know, we know there's tremendous need and shortage and gap all across the county. There's tremendous growth coming to this county. We need housing in all different segments of our population and something, you know, that's really focused on equity, but we don't have a plan.
two proposals we got in particular that are in outlying communities are actually, even though there's not transit, they're sited really well in the downtown areas with walkable access to schools, parks, health clinics, grocery, other amenities. So if that's of any consolation, you know, they're good developments and they're sited in as good a way as they can be in a community that doesn't have transit. But
thanks.
Anyone else have any question on 205 or 235? Okay, I
should
mentioned
note, if I may, Jerry, too, that Majid participated in our work group representing the Planning Division, so thank you, Majid, for your involvement.
Okay. Thanks, Majid.
Just by putting it out.
So, could I please have a motion to approve the equity plan as such, presented?
The resolution.
The resolution.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion on that? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Now could I please have a motion of support for changing the name of Squabby?
Moved.
Second.
Any further discussion or questions?
I have a question. Just quickly, do you think that this timeline that's in the resolution of October 1 is doable?
It'll be initiated. We've already got a handle on the application. Hans is already aware of it and prepared to start work on it. But the application process takes quite a bit of time. It involves both state and federal agencies, and it can be a time-consuming and lengthy process. So we're certainly initiating it as soon as possible. I can't meet with the, what's the timeline of the presentation?
It says make application to the Wisconsin Geographic Names Council by October 1st to change the name. So I understand it sounds like there's a lot of work involved, so that might not happen by then, but.
Yeah, we'll certainly make every effort to do so. Do you know why the October 1st date was cited?
I don't know.
But it's in process, and we'll submit it as soon as possible. The application form itself isn't particularly onerous, but it's the process and the lengthy process and moving back from other agencies at higher levels of government that takes more time.
I just wanted to ask in case you won't need to request that deadline be pushed back, but if there's not any sort of consequence for not meeting that deadline, that we need to adjust that time.
To make application. We can give you some feedback. I don't know that we'll have submitted the application by October 1st, but I'll talk to Hans and see what that entails. I know part of the application involves getting support from other communities, so it may involve resolutions of the city council and from Madison and from Monona, and to help build this case that there's local support for this name change.
Okay.
That part of it might take time.
If we needed to approve it with the condition that if it's not by October 1st, that's okay, like with an extended timeline. Or we can approve it as it is, and that's okay.
I wouldn't know a date to give you, so I'd recommend just sticking with it as is. But if I'll talk to Hans before the county board meeting and then can communicate back to you and let you know if it's not going to be like until January 2020 or something like that. I would recommend that we stick with that date, kind of just keep it moving forward. But if I learned something interesting and noteworthy, I'll let you know.
Yeah, for your benefit if you did.
Any more questions?
Thank you.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carries. We have no ordinance amendments. We don't have items requiring committee action. Reports to committee, we have a report of approved CSMs.
Yeah, so my attachment didn't make it on the agenda when Roger ran the publisher. But anyway, so it was just a little bit of a timing gap. So therefore, I printed off the hard copy of what's been approved and signed since the last board meeting.
Okay. Any questions regarding the CSM staff department? Hearing none? I don't even think we approved these, did we?
No.
So, okay, is there any business, other business authorized by law? If not, could I please have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We're adjourned.